Welcome to the Marina Barrage in Singapore. It's a dam which serves as a tidal barrier. Prior to its construction, the Singapore River and all the water you're seeing behind me was brackish. The large freshwater reservoir, which is now formed behind the dam, is important for Singapore's water supply. Not only is this a very beautiful part of Singapore, the flat surface on top of the dam provides a nice, unblocked surface for installing solar panels. The Marina Barrage has 504 individual solar panels on it. The total peak power available from all the solar panels combined is 84 kilowatts. In other words, that's the power that you would get out of this system if the sun were in the most advantageous position in the sky on a nice day with a clear blue sky. Although all the solar panels are nicely arranged into a grid, they're actually grouped into 11 different systems. You could think of them as 11 small solar power plants, each injecting power into the grid in parallel. I'm going to measure the surface area of one panel. As we can see, each panel is 81 centimeters wide and 161 centimeters tall. If I multiply the surface area of one panel by the total number of panels, which in this array, array number 9, is 145 panels, we find that the total surface area is 189 square meters. How much power would be coming from the sunlight falling on these panels in the best case scenario? Well, the power density of usable sunlight is in the neighborhood of 1,000 watts per square meter. That means that the raw solar power contained in the photons falling on these 145 panels would be about 189 kilowatts, but that's the best case scenario. Solar panels on their own produce DC electricity. In order to inject that power to the grid, we need to convert it into AC. And as you've seen from one of my previous videos on solar cells, the voltage and the current at which solar cell operates most efficiently varies with the amount of sunlight falling on it. Therefore, a complicated control system is needed to ensure that each solar panel is operating at its most efficient point or its maximum power point. These inverters that we're looking at right now do that particular job. Inverter number 9, for example, is an SMA STP25000TL string inverter. There are 145 individual solar panels connected to this inverter. It not only ensures that each of the 145 solar panels is operating at its maximum power point, it also converts the DC power at whatever voltage is the most optimum for the array into an AC grid voltage. The inverter synthesizes a sine wave, ensuring that the voltage amplitude of the sine wave is slightly higher than that of the grid, such that the current flowing out of the inverter exactly matches the amount of current that the panels are able to give us at their point of maximum power output. Right now, it looks like this inverter is giving us 17 kilowatts of power. With a number of other different brands of inverters here too, each of them being connected to a number of different solar panels, we can't really compare one to the other by looking at the numbers here on the screens. But what we can say is that inverter number 9 has a peak capacity, or nameplate capacity, of 25.375 kilowatts. It's currently injecting 17 kilowatts into the grid, and the 145 panels it's connected to would have 189 kilowatts of sunlight falling on them in the best case scenario. The net conversion efficiency for solar power plant number 9 here would thus be about 9%, but that's only if we would have 1,000 watts per square meter hitting the solar panels, but that's not what we have right now. Under current conditions, we probably have a number somewhat less than 1,000 watts per square meter. In reality, our solar power plant here probably has an efficiency closer to 13 or 14%. One of the difficulties associated with solar power plants in general is that the amount of power that they inject into the grid is variable. If a cloud blocks the sun, there's a sudden drop in the amount of power injected to the grid. And as we've seen from previous videos, power needs to be consumed the moment it is produced. So if the power consumption doesn't simultaneously drop at the same moment that a cloud blocks the sun, the grid voltage is going to drop. Because Singapore has a fairly large electricity grid, the effect on the grid of having a few solar panels here at the Marina Barrage being powered down is going to be fairly small. But we could imagine that if the percentage of solar power as a fraction of the total generation capacity in Singapore were to increase in the future, there could hypothetically be problems with grid stability. There are various ways to solve that problem. The easiest way is to have gas turbines, which can quickly power up and compensate for any shortfall. Another option is to start looking into the ways that the grid could store some of the electricity produced when it's really sunny and then have it give that power back when it's not as sunny. It's still a big challenge because of the costs associated with batteries and other types of energy storage, mostly because the amount of energy storage needed is so large. Another minor difficulty associated with solar power plants is that we do have a number of different inverters online, injecting power to the grid simultaneously. What happens if a power line needs to be serviced or the utility company needs to shut off the power line for some other reason? With a traditional power plant, it's very easy to simply disconnect it from the grid. We can be sure then that somebody working on an ordinarily live electrical wire wouldn't be electrocuted. But if we have a lot of renewables connected to the same electricity grid, how can we be sure that an electricity grid is safe? In fact, each one of the inverters here continuously monitors the grid. If an inverter detects a fault condition, for example, that the voltage on the grid suddenly drops to zero, which would happen if there were intentional or unintentional fault, then one of the key jobs of the inverter is to disconnect its solar panels from the grid immediately. We wouldn't want somebody to assume that a power line is safe to work on only to be electrocuted because one of these inverters fails to disconnect its panels from the grid during an outage. As you can see, it's a rather complicated scenario, and this very important safety function of inverters is one of the reasons why they have to be certified and installed carefully. In our next video, we're going to take a look at electricity grids more generally, how they're designed, how they're arranged, and how power is typically transmitted from power plants to consumers. We have a whole series of professionally filmed and edited videos in order to help students learn the fundamentals of electricity. If you like watching this particular video, then you might like to check out some of our others too.